If you have your Bible, which I hope you do, please open it to Mark chapter 13, verse 32. Mark chapter 13, verse 32. There was a report on CNN this morning, and I'm going to read this text to you, and I'm quoting, "The Grimvatn volcano under the Vatnajökull glacier in Iceland was erupting Saturday, according to the Icelandic Meteorological Office. A dark cloud of smoke was rising from the glacier, and scientists were flying over the scene to evaluate the event, according to CNN affiliate TV2 Iceland," end quote. Okay, we know what that text says because we just heard it. But the question we're asking today is, what does that text mean? I might ask three people, what does this text mean? And the first person might say, well, I think it means that a volcano erupted under a glacier in Iceland. And you would say, well, that's possibly what it meant. But someone else might say, no, there's a much deeper meaning than that. Much deeper meaning than that. It means that the cumulative anger of the Icelandic people over the dark cloud of the foreboding economic crisis in that little island is erupting over the chilly relations with Greenland. And some people might say, okay. And then a third person might say, no, I think what that text means is that scientists in Iceland can fly. It says it right there, the scientists were flying over the scene. It's amazing what people can draw out of something that seems pretty straightforward on the surface. We figure out what the Bible says by observation. We did that last week. Now we need to figure out what the Bible means, and we do this through what's called interpretation. Interpretation. The technical word is hermeneutics, but you don't need to know that. The basic question we're trying to answer is, what does the text mean? We're learning how to read the Bible. We talked the first week about the fact that the Holy Spirit is involved, that every time we open God's Word, we need to pray and say, Holy Spirit, use this time, speak to me, reveal yourself to me, so that it can be a supernatural event, not just an academic exercise. We talked a couple weeks ago about the story, this grand historical plan that God has in place, and that we need to understand individual passages in the context of the grand scheme. We talked last week about seeing, about observing what's in the text. So this week we talk about surrounding, interpretation 101. Interpretation is simply figuring out what the author means. The technical term is authorial intent. What did the author intend to convey when he wrote these words? One author has said it this way: the goal of interpretation is to think God's thoughts after him. To think God's thoughts after him. I'm going to give you three specific questions to ask that will help you in the task of interpretation. You might want to write these down. I hope to get to all three of them. Number one, is my understanding of this text speculation or revelation? Speculation or revelation? Number two, is my understanding of this text a description or a prescription? A description or a prescription? And number three, is my understanding of this text in isolation or in association? And you're saying, Pete, those are a lot of big, long words. Well, let's dive in and hopefully they'll make sense. Question number one, is my understanding of this text speculation or revelation? Speculation simply means that I'm drawing a conclusion or I'm developing a theory or basing an opinion on some of the facts, an incomplete group of facts. Revelation means that I'm trusting that God is revealing his truth to me in its entirety. I'm trusting that God is revealing his truth to me. Many of you are aware that there's a gentleman out west by the name of Harold Camping who predicted a number of months ago that the world was going to end yesterday, right, on May 21st. He said that the rapture of Jesus was going to happen yesterday. The world as we know it would end. And so there was a big push to get people to say yes to Jesus before that happened yesterday. Harold was wrong. He was sincere, but he was sincerely wrong. And the reason he was wrong is because he based his thinking more on speculation and on mathematical calculations than he did on revelation. Because you see, we don't need to speculate about things that God has spoken very clearly about. I ask you to turn to Mark chapter 13, verse 32. Mark chapter 13, verse 32. Listen to what Jesus says about the timing of his second coming. This is Jesus speaking about the timing of his second coming. No one knows about that day or hour. Stop. That's pretty clear, isn't it? No one knows about that day or hour. Not even the angels in heaven. Listen, nor the Son. Jesus said, I don't even know. But only the Father. God the Father is the only one who knows. Be on guard. Be alert. You do not know when that time will come. It's like a man going out. He leaves his house and he puts his servants in charge, each with his assigned task. And he tells the one at the door to keep watch. Therefore, keep watch because you do not know when the owner of the house will come back, whether in the evening or at midnight or when the rooster crows or at dawn. If he comes suddenly, don't let him find you sleeping. What I say to you, I say to everyone, watch. Where we have clear revelation, there is no need for speculation, right? Clear revelation. Jesus said, no one knows the day. Angels don't, I don't. No one knows. And the Father wants it this way. Why does the Father want it this way? Because he wants us thinking it might happen any day. Here's what Revelation has been very clear about the end of time. Jesus is coming back. He wants us ready when he gets here. Those are the two things we know. Jesus is coming back. He wants us ready when he gets here. Everything else is speculation. Speculation is not necessarily when we have clear revelation on the question. Second thing I want you to think about is this. Is my understanding of this text a description or a prescription? A description or a prescription? We need to know the difference between descriptive passages and prescriptive passages. A descriptive passage describes the way things are. A prescriptive passage prescribes the way they should be. You hear the difference? When you go to the doctor, he diagnoses something. He prescribes medicine. He's saying, here, I want you to take this medicine. A prescriptive passage has said, here's something I would like you to do, to think, to feel, to be a part of. A descriptive passage simply describes the way things are. It's really important to ask the question whenever you're reading something, is this descriptive or prescriptive? A few weeks ago, Osama bin Laden was caught and killed. And there was enormous reaction around the world on various degrees of the spectrum, right? Here in America, some people were celebrating wildly, other people were grieving or were uncomfortable with that. And the blogs all blew up about how Christians should respond or should not respond to the death of Osama bin Laden. And these blogs almost always had Bible passages. And so, and some people said, you know what, it's totally cool for us to celebrate the death of this man. Because Proverbs 11:10 says, when the righteous prosper, the city rejoices. When the wicked perish, there are shouts of joy. See, God's telling us to shout for joy. Is God telling us to shout for joy in that passage? Was that a prescriptive passage or a descriptive passage? Let me read it again. When the righteous prosper, the city rejoices. When the wicked perish, there are shouts of joy. That's a descriptive passage. It's describing what generally happens in the world. It's not telling us to be happy when someone dies. You see the importance of understanding the difference between prescriptive and descriptive passages. Those two things are really important. This third one is the one we're going to obviously spend the bulk of our time on. When I'm reading a passage, I need to ask myself this. Is my understanding of this text in isolation or in association? And this is the whole question of context. Context. Write the word context on your notes. Let me define it for you. It's made up of two words. Con, which means with. Text, which means text. So context means with the text. The context is simply the stuff that comes with the text. The stuff that comes before the text, the verse you're looking at, and the stuff that comes after the text. The context, right? Ron Julian says this about context. Context is that indispensable ally that allows a reader to move from what the author's words might mean to what he intended them to mean. Among all the tools that make communication possible, context is king. This is an incredibly important concept to understand, that whenever we're reading a portion of Scripture, we've got to know the context around it. Kay Arthur said, "The rule of context is that context rules." The rule of context is that context rules. Let me show you why this is important. We can't just look at a word and figure out what it means unless we know the context that word is found in. I'm going to throw out a word, and I want you to think of an image in your mind of that word, okay? Here's the word, horn. Horn. Raise your hand if you're thinking about a bony appendage coming out of the head of a cow. Raise your hand. There you go. Some of you are thinking of that kind of horn. Okay, a different kind of horn. It's an instrument you play in seventh grade band. Raise your hand if you're a musician. There you go. A very necessary part in driving a car, it's situated right in the middle of your steering wheel and it makes a loud noise, a horn. Raise your hand. Yes. A tool in which you use to get shoes on, a shoehorn. Raise your hand if you're thinking about putting your shoes on. Two of you, very good. Okay, so the question is, what does horn mean? And the answer is, well, it can mean different things depending on the context. So here's the sentence. Tell me which one I was thinking of. Jim tried to horn in on my territory by stealing my iPhone and my contacts. Wait, we weren't even thinking about that meaning of horn. You see how important context is? You've got to read what comes before, and you've got to read what comes after if you're going to understand what God is trying to convey to you. My dad always said it this way, a text without a context is a pretext for a proof text. A text without a context, so a passage of Scripture without what comes before and after it, is a pretext, is the first step towards a proof text. A proof text is taking a passage of Scripture, listen, and making it say something it doesn't say. People do it all the time. As my dad got older, I don't know if he got tired saying that whole thing, he came up with a new one that's shorter. A text without a context is just a con. A text without a context is just a con. When you study a verse, always consult the neighbors. Always consult the neighbors. Always read what comes before and after. Always read the whole paragraph. Don't rely on close-ups. Take a wide-angle picture first and then dive deep into the text. Sometimes taking something out of context really doesn't matter, in all honesty. Many times, a verse can stand simply by itself and convey the meaning of the entire paragraph. So just because someone in a sermon, for example, says a verse without the whole context, don't think, oh no, he's trying to get away with something. A lot of times it works just fine. That being said, there is great danger in taking passages out of their context. Sometimes taking something out of the context leads to just silly theology. A friend of mine said he saw a guy out in East Texas with a t-shirt on, which read, I think myself happy. I think myself happy. And the reference was Acts 26:2. I think myself happy. And he asked him about it. He said, hey, tell me about your t-shirt. And he said, oh, my pastor passed these out in our church. And he told us that this is in the Bible. And what it means is that if we're unhappy, God doesn't want that. And the way that we get happy is we think ourselves happy. And he taught us how to think ourselves happy. And he used this verse as his evidence that this is how God wants to do it. So my friend was curious and he thought, is that really in the Bible? So he went to read the text and it's Acts 26:2. It's from the King James Version. Here's what the whole verse says. It's when Paul is offering his defense before King Agrippa. It said, I think myself happy, King Agrippa, because I shall answer for myself this day. I think myself happy is the King James way of saying, I consider myself fortunate, or I'm really glad I get to say this. Yeah, let's take that and build theology out of it, shall we? Here's the problem with this. The Bible doesn't teach you if you just think yourself happy, it'll work. It doesn't teach that. It doesn't teach anything like that. And when we take a passage out of context and make it say something the Bible doesn't say, here's what happened. People say, well, that didn't work. The Bible must not be true. And we undermine the authority of God's word by messing around with it like this. taking something out of context can really be scary as well. Howard Hendricks tells the story of playing hide-and-seek when he was a little boy, and he found himself in an attic hiding from the other kids, and there was a placard nailed on the wall, and it said, quote, "Work out your salvation with fear and trembling," end quote, Philippians 2:12. Work out your salvation with fear and trembling. And he said, I started fearfully trembling because that verse told me I've got to start working out my salvation. And I knew I could never do it. And I thought, it'll never happen for me. And I started to wonder if I could ever be saved. All from one little verse taken out of context. He said, a little while later, I was talking to someone about it, and they took me to the Bible. And they said, well, read the very next verse too. And so they took me to Philippians chapter 2, verse 13. And it says, for it is God who works in you to will and to act according to his good purpose. And this person explained to him, you don't work for salvation. That's the exact opposite of what the Bible teaches. The Bible teaches everywhere that it's God's grace that brings salvation to us. It's the work of Christ on the cross. It's God's work of initiating salvation. And they preach the real truth to him. And he's like, oh, what a difference context makes. What a difference context makes. Sometimes taking something out of context is just flat out dangerous. The cults do this. All the cults do this. Read the doctrinal statement of any cult and you will find passages ripped from their context, theologies built on them, and scores of people led astray. Sometimes taking something out of context can lead to tragic doctrinal teaching. And I'm going to preface what I'm about to say next with these words. I enter into this with fear and trembling because I'm going to speak specifically to a book that's on the market right now that does what I'm describing. I don't know in 19 years if I've ever done this before. This book has so deeply troubled me, I'm going to feel free to do it as your shepherd, okay? The name of the book is Love Wins by Rob Bell, subtitled A Book About Heaven, Hell, and the fate of every person who ever lived. I'm not going to give a book review right now, but what I'm going to point out is two specific places where Rob takes something out of context to say something that it simply doesn't say with tragic results. Tragic results. Let me walk you through this. Rob is arguing in this book for the idea that God might give people a chance to choose Jesus after they die. Okay? He's arguing that God might give people a chance to choose Jesus after they die. In the preface of his book, he tips his hand. Here's what he says, and I quote, "A staggering number of people have been taught that a select few Christians will spend forever in a peaceful, joyous place called heaven, while the rest of humanity spends forever in torment and punishment in hell with no chance for anything better. It's been clearly communicated to many that this belief is a central truth of the Christian faith, and to reject it is, in essence, to reject Jesus." Listen, this is misguided and toxic, and ultimately subverts the contagious spread of Jesus' message of love, peace, forgiveness, and joy that our world desperately needs to hear, end quote. I don't know if you heard what I just heard, but what Rob does there is he quotes the orthodox belief, the orthodox doctrine of salvation by grace through faith, and then he calls it misguided and toxic. In his book, he argues that surely there's an opportunity after people die to say yes. Surely, ultimately, love wins. He does this with a lot of different strategies, but in one place, he says this. "And then there are others who can live with the two destinations, heaven and hell, two realities after death, but insist that there must be some kind of second chance for those who don't believe in Jesus in this lifetime." So now he's talking about people who insist that there is a second chance. In a letter, Martin Luther, one of the leaders of the Protestant Reformation, wrote to Hans von Reckenberg in 1522, about the possibility that people could turn to God after death asking, quote, "Who would doubt God's ability to do that?" end quote. Again, a good question. So what Rob is doing here is he is implying that in that list of people who would insist that there is a second chance after death, he would put Martin Luther on that list, because in this one letter, Martin Luther said, "Who would doubt God's ability to do that?" That is a text taken out of context. Let me read you the context. In this letter, Martin Luther is answering a question raised by his friend, Hans von Reckenbach. And the question is it possible to be saved without faith? And Luther's answer is a clear no. In fact, the letter is specifically aimed at refuting any notion that anyone can be saved in any way other than by faith. And he says, "It would be quite a different question whether God can impart faith to some in the hour of death or after death so that these people could be saved through faith. Who would doubt God's ability to do that?" Listen. "No one, however, can prove that he does do this." Here's what Martin Luther is saying. Could God do that? Yes, God could do that, but there's absolutely no evidence anywhere to lead us to believe that he does. Martin Luther is saying the exact opposite of what Rob Bell is inferring that he's saying. To infer that Luther would insist that there must be some kind of second chance is at very best a misrepresentation of Luther's position. It's one thing to take a human writer out of context and make him say something he's not. It's a completely different ballgame when you take God's word and do the same thing. And later in his book, this is exactly what Rob does. Turn in your Bible, please, to John chapter 12, verse 44. John chapter 12, verse 44. Near the end of Rob's book, he's starting to give us some applications for this concept. And I quote from page 160 of his book. "Third, it is our responsibility to be extremely careful about making negative, decisive, lasting judgments about people's eternal destinies. As Jesus says, he, quote, did not come to judge the world, but to save the world," end quote, John chapter 12. Okay, so the entirety of the passage that is quoted is this phrase. Jesus says, he did not come to judge the world, but to save the world, John chapter 12. Okay, so let's go to John chapter 12 and read the text, because a text without a context is a pretext for a proof text. Verse 44, "Then Jesus cried out, 'When a man believes in me, he does not believe in me only, but in the one who sent me. When he looks at me, he sees the one who sent me. I have come into the world as a light, so that no one who believes in me should stay in darkness.'" Okay, so the one who sent me, the Father, and I are one. If you see me, you see the Father. We are one and the same, is what he's saying. Verse 47, "As for the people who hear my words, but does not keep them, I do not judge him," here's the part that Rob quotes, "for I did not come to judge the world, but to save it." Very next verse, verse 48, listen. "There is a judge for the one who rejects me and does not accept my words. That very word which I spoke will condemn him at the last day. For I did not speak of my own accord, but the Father who sent me commanded me what to say and how to say it. I know that his command leads to eternal life, so that whatever I say is just what the Father has told me to say." Here's the argument that Jesus is making. "I'm one with the Father. I came this time in the incarnation to bring salvation, to do the work necessary to bring salvation. I'm not here right now to judge you," is what he's saying. "I'm here to save." But they said, "Make sure you understand, though, that I'm going to be coming again. And if you don't trust me, there will be condemnation in that day." That's what he's saying. That's the clear teaching of Scripture all the way through Scripture. But just a portion of the verse is pulled out. It's like saying scientists in Iceland can fly. But it's much more important than that, my friends. Much more important, because obviously the stakes in this case are much, much greater. Rob's primary mistake is he is resting on speculation instead of revelation. And remember, whenever there is clear revelation, speculation is not necessary. We know what God already thinks. Is it possible that God gives people a second chance after they die? Yes, it's possible. Is it probable that he does so? By no means. Is it possible that God could have created our earth without a moon? Yes. Did he? No. There is evidence contrary to that concept, right? There's at least two reasons why I know this is true. Nowhere in Scripture is there a hint that there is a second chance after we die. You would think if there was, he might have mentioned it. You think? He had ample opportunities. Hebrews 9:27. Just as a man is destined to die once and after that to face the judgment, so Christ was sacrificed once to take away the sins of many people. If there really was a second chance, the verse probably could have read like this. Just as man is destined to die once, and then we'll have that opportunity for all those who rejected Christ on earth to receive him, and then after that, we'll have the judgment. But that's an argument from silence. Arguments from silence are always dangerous. So let me tell you the second reason why I think Rob is wrong. The second reason is because all over Scripture there are warnings that the judgment for those who don't know Jesus and don't trust him in this lifetime is real. Now turn to 2 Thessalonians 1:3, please. 2 Thessalonians 1:3. Before Rob's book came out, he did a video, a marketing video, to conjure up interest so the people would buy his book, and it worked. It really worked. People saw the video and were extremely concerned with the direction that this book was taking. People quickly jumped all over Rob before they'd even read the book, which is not a wise thing to do. You always want to read something before you critique it, general rule. But as I was listening to what Rob said on the video, my heart was deeply troubled, and I was concerned. And that day, in my quiet time, I was reading in 2 Thessalonians chapter 1. And these are the words of God's revelation to us. Listen. We ought always to thank God for you, brothers, and rightly so, because your faith is growing more and more, and the love every one of you has for each other is increasing. Therefore, among God's churches, we boast about your perseverance and faith in all the persecutions and trials you are enduring. All this is evidence that God's judgment is right, and as a result, you will be counted worthy of the kingdom of God for which you are suffering. God is just, listen. He will pay back trouble to those who trouble you and give relief to those who are troubled and to us as well. This will happen when the Lord Jesus is revealed from heaven in blazing fire with his powerful angels. So on the day that Jesus shows up, all this is going to happen. What's going to happen? He, verse 8, will punish those who do not know God and do not obey the gospel of our Lord Jesus. They will be punished with everlasting destruction and shut out from the presence of the Lord and from the majesty of his power on the day he comes to be glorified in his holy people and to be marveled at among all those who have believed. This includes you because you believed our testimony to you. My friends, where there is clear revelation, speculation is not necessary. Let me read it again. They will be punished with everlasting destruction and shut out from the presence of the Lord and from the majesty of his power on the day he comes to be glorified in his holy people and to be marveled at among those who have believed. My friends, the stakes are so high on this thing right here. Really, really high. Because if Rob is right and love wins and everyone gets saved at the end, well, then we don't need to worry about anything, do we? We're good to go. But if he's wrong, and this passage is right, the problem with this mindset that maybe there's a second chance and that anyone who sees Jesus face to face will obviously turn towards him, the problem with that mindset is that someone who doesn't know him will read that and say, cool, I'm good. I'll just say yes then. And there is the potential to consign millions to a godless eternity. It is not more loving to walk by a burning house and see someone in the window and say, don't worry, it's not really burning. That's not loving. It's more loving to say, get out. Get out while you can. Do you think context matters? Do you think context matters? I think it's appropriate to say, to answer in this context, hell yes, it matters. It does. And for those of you who are more concerned about the fact that I just said hell in my sermon than you are about the passage I just read, please go back and read the passage again. It tells us that people who don't say yes to Jesus will be eternally condemned and separated from God forever. It can't be stated any clearer than that. Context matters. That passage, by the way, did not find it into Rob's book. Not there. So when we're reading Scripture, we've got to look at the immediate context, what comes before and after. We've got to look at the biblical context. We've got to look at what the rest of Scripture says about this theme or topic. I was always taught the best commentary on Scripture is Scripture. The best commentary on Scripture is Scripture. What does the rest of Scripture have to say about this? We need to look at the theological context. Have you ever been to a progressive dinner? You ever been to one of those things where you go to one house and you eat the hors d'oeuvres, and you go to the next house and eat the main meal, and the next house and dessert? Scripture is a progressive dinner, if you will. As time went on, God revealed more and more and more of himself. So when you're reading Scripture, you have to ask yourself, when did this portion of Scripture happen? That's part of the context. Did it happen before the cross or after the cross? Did it happen before the giving of the law or after the giving of the law? Did it happen before the exile or after the exile? Did it happen before the Holy Spirit was given or after the Holy Spirit was given? You have to ask the theological context as well. You need to ask questions about the literary context, because the Bible is written in a whole bunch of different genres, and we're going to talk about this more next week. Depending on what kind of genre we're looking at, we're going to interpret it a little differently. We need to look at key words like therefore and but and realize that they are contextual words. We need to do all that, but at the end of the day, here's my plea. Don't read a verse without reading the paragraph it's in. Just read the paragraph it's in. Make sure you're seeing it in its context so that you can know exactly what God's trying to convey to you. Would you do this? Would you just bow and pray with me, please? Lord, this was supposed to be a message about interpreting Scripture, which I guess partially it was. But as this thing played out, it became more and more about this incredible truth that, yes, you are passionately in love with humanity. That is true. Rob got that part right in his book. Passionately in love with humanity, so much so that you were willing to send your son to live this life, to die this death, to rise again, to ascend to heaven, to send his spirit, and then one day to return to gather us up and to judge those who have rejected you and turned their back on you. And Lord, just as I'm preaching this biblical truth, I'm guessing that there's someone here who has yet to say yes to you. And maybe as I was reading that text today, something started burning in their heart and they realized their need to say yes, to ask for your forgiveness, to ask for you to recreate them into a new person, to rescue them. And so I just want to give them a chance to do that. In the quietness of their own heart, they can pray this prayer after me. Lord Jesus, thank you for being real. I believe that you are. Thank you for coming to live in human form as a man. I believe you did that. Thank you for dying on the cross, finishing the work necessary to save me. Thank you for coming back to life and being alive today so I can talk to you. Lord Jesus, I surrender myself to you in this moment. I ask you to wash my sin away. I ask you by your Spirit to come and live inside me, transform me, change me. Take my sin and give me your righteousness. Make me a new creation, I pray. Rescuing me from myself, from sin, from death, and from the coming wrath. I surrender myself to you, Jesus. Lord, I want to pray for my brothers and sisters. I want to pray for your protection as we read the Bible, that you would, by your Spirit, reveal to us the truth. And that if we get confused, we'd have brothers and sisters around us who would say, "Ooh, wait a minute, I'm not sure that's what it's saying." And we would have ears to hear, and we would listen to one another in the context of community. We'd make sure we know what you're saying. And Lord, as brothers and sisters in Christ, I pray we never forget what you told us in 2 Thessalonians 1, the truth of that. And that the people that we love around us who don't know you, our family members and our friends and our coworkers and the people who live on our street and the kids that we go to school with who don't know you are in grave danger, Lord Jesus. Don't let us forget. Do this work in us by your Spirit, I pray. And I pray it all in Jesus' powerful and precious name. Amen.